Someplace where there's no oil, floor of the urine. Magma starts coming up. Did you hit oil? No. Right? I tell someone else, hey, go over there and dig a little bit. And it's like a rich, you know, like a geosurvey. You know, there's tons of pockets of oil. And they dig for a day, a week, maybe 2 weeks. Boom! They hit oil. They're going to be rich. Right? Was working hard the main ingredient then? No. Right? So if you don't understand the full truth, a lot of times these half-truths can be very, very damaging. So today, what I want to do is share with you a really important half-truth that I discovered like way too late in my career. If I had discovered it when I was your age, I think I would have gone much further. So I just want to share that with you. You can take it or leave it as you please. And you know, I want to also hear from you at the end if you think it's true or not, if that's what's causing your experience. So real quick, back row over there. Those gentlemen, please stand up just for one moment. Back row, yeah, that's you. Back up, stand up just for one moment. Okay, everyone look, everyone stare at them. Not because they're in the back row, but just stare at them for purposes of whatever. All right, great. What's your name? Okay, so imagine all of them are in a conference room together, right? It's a boardroom, it could be a government office. They are in the halls of power, whether it's a private company or a nonprofit. And then all of a sudden, you know who walks in? Tom Brady. Not actual Tom Brady, but a guy who looks like Tom Brady. Like, looks exactly like Tom Brady. And these five gentlemen, right? Ask yourself this question. Who are most people going to think is in charge? Who? Shout out. Who's in charge? Tom Brady.
Do you think Tom Brady reached his full potential?
Do I think Tom Brady, he got pretty close if he didn't.
What do you think? Like, yes or no?
Yeah, I think he did.
You think you reached his limit?
What's that?
So you think that, like, as a person, there's a limit to your potential?
No, you can always do more. We're always improving, right?
So
yeah, absolutely. It's a great point. You can always improve. However, I would say he's reached a level of potential that others maybe can only dream of, right? So, we know that there's a problem. Let's talk about solutions, right? We come to hear about problems, right? So there are solutions. So I like to call this the leadership passing, right? So imagine all of you on this side are people who are trying to become leaders, right? So you're on one side, and here in the middle, there's a whitewater rapids. Anyone ever go whitewater rapids?
Yes.
It's scary, right? Like class 5 or 6, I forget what it is. It's like scary. Like, I actually can't swim, so I'm definitely scared of whitewater rapids. So you all are the deciders. You have the power, all right? Feel the power. You guys have the power. All of you are the young upstarts. You want the power, right? You're applying for the jobs, right? Now, just imagine that the people over here don't think you're Tom Brady, right? They don't think you've got the stuff, okay? So, let's say you're standing over here and saying, hey, I got the stuff. Come over here, cross the whitewater rapids, and join with me because I have the stuff. How do you think that's going to go? Do you think they're going to jump into the whitewater rapids and climb over and say, yeah, I'm with you? No, forget it. Right? So there's this wide chasm between their perception of your ability and where you are. I'm not saying you don't have the ability, but their perception is over here. Your perception, what you know you can do, is over there. Now, what's necessary for them to come over to your side? Right now there's a river, whitewater rapids. What would be helpful for them to come over to your side? A bridge. Yeah, exactly. I'm not going to jump in the water. I got my nice suit on. I got my expensive clothes or whatever. I jump into the water and get wet to come over to your side for no reason. I want a bridge, right? Now, there's a bridge, but still, maybe they don't want to come over, right? They're happy where they are. They're good, right? So what can you do to make it easier for them or to make it more likely for them to cross the bridge? Besides staying right there, what can you do? Cross the bridge. Right? So now you're over here, right? And you're like, look at me, I'm great, I can do it. And they're like, no, I don't think so. So you cross the bridge, and you come over and you're like, hey, it's kind of different over here, right? Everything's shinier, right? Smells better, cleaner, it's nice. Oh, I'm looking over here. I can kind of see why they might not want to cross this river. I can kind of see why they may not think that I got the stuff. And here's the key. Here's the solution. When you can see things from their perspective, you can start to get them to be like, you know what? Yeah, let's go over. Right? If you say, just do what I want to do, just think the way I want to think, they're going to be like, no, we're in charge. Why would we do that? Right? But if you're over here and you're like, you know what? I get it. You've never hired a person from this sort of school before. Right? All the leaders in this organization have come from a certain family or a certain way of doing it. I get it. Let me share with you a couple things about why I think I might be a good leader or things I have in common with those that you might not recognize on the surface. Now, you have a much better chance of them saying, hey, I never really thought about that before. Let me go over here, right? And say, you know what, I do see you as a leader. I'm gonna give you a shot. So that's the type of thing that you need to be able to do to solve a Tom Brady-like problem, where people aren't gonna see you the way you want to be seen, just because it's true, just because you work hard, just because you're shouting, I can do it, it doesn't matter. They have to see it from their perspective, or they're not gonna see it. Now, second tip, and I love this tip, this will help you a lot, if anyone here is interested in business, dreams of going on Shark Tank, raising money for a business, maybe not, dropping out of college in like the first or second year and opening the next Facebook or whatever, this will be good advice for you. So, imagine you're in a room and there's 4 venture capitalists there, right? Really rich people, doesn't matter what they look like, might be a woman, might be a man, whatever. And they're used to investing in Silicon Valley type firms. So they're used to seeing a guy up there with a hoodie, certain height,
brown hair,
right? You know, just looking like an average kind of CEO of a Silicon Valley firm, right? And you don't look like that. Let's just assume for purposes of argument, you don't fit that mold, right? Either your style or your background or maybe even your accent, right? Maybe you're from the South, or maybe you're from somewhere, maybe you're from Germany and you don't have that accent, right? So now, you walk in there and you give a great presentation. Awesome, slides are popping, everything's so great, you're making jokes, it's great, and then you leave, and guess who walks in after you? Tom Brady! You got a problem again, this guy is haunting you, right? Who do you think is more likely to get that money? Tom Brady! Why, is it because he's smarter than you? Not necessarily. Is it because he's worked harder than you? Maybe not, right? It's because they expect Tom Brady to succeed, because that's what's gone before, that's the expectation. So that's reality A. So let's change it to reality B. Now imagine, right, you walk in there, again, same thing, and one of the people who's the venture capitalist, one out of four, they know you. Maybe you ran into them at Starbucks, maybe your uncle or someone in your family is friendly with them and they knew you were going to be on the show and they said, hey, you know, talk to my cousin, talk to my nephew. And they got to know you and they got really excited about your idea, right? Wow, this idea is really great. And I'm just going to say, you know, imagine your name is Pat, right? So then you walk in, Pat, Pat, you walk in and that one person says to the other three sharks, you know what, I talked to Pat last week. He's got phenomenal ideas. This kid is so talented. I know we typically don't invest with someone with these sorts of ideas, but I want you all to pay close attention because we got a real gem. How many of you think you would have a better chance? Yeah, you'd have a much better chance. You're still competing against Tom Brady, right? But now you have a much better chance because someone else has supported you and saying, look, you know, might not be visible on the surface, but this person has a lot of potential. This idea has a lot of potential. So they did this study where they showed 25% is a bit of a magical number, okay? When you have a minority viewpoint, right, people start to switch over to it and say, you know what, I think that's okay. You know, I think that's cool. There's a magic that happens at about 25%, roughly, right, one out of four, right? Where all of a sudden the minority viewpoint switches to the majority viewpoint. So there's going to be situations in your future where you're interviewing on a panel, where you're trying out for stuff, where you're going for a promotion, where there are people who are going to be assessing your readiness, right? Maybe that happens already for those of you in sports, right? They're assessing for different, you know, drama or different, people are assessing, like, are you ready? Music, like, first chair or second chair, right? Imagine the difference when people in that room know who you are already. Already support you. And here's the beauty of it. You don't have to walk into the room as a stranger, right? How often in life do we have no idea who's going to be there in the room, right? You knew I was going to be here. You could have found out who I was and said, oh, you know, I like what Joe has to say. I don't like what Joe has to say. You could have fallen asleep already. You could have set a time, right? So most of the time, you have an idea of who's going to be in there. So what I always tell people, right, whether you're in high school, college, whether you're a seasoned executive, or even a CEO, three words. I want you to remember them, right? There's only three words to take besides, you know, the Tom Brady problem. I want you to take three words. Stack the deck. Stack it, right? Find out who that person is or who those people are and start getting to know them. Say, hey, can we grab a coffee? Oh, can I send you an article? Can I have a quick chat with you, just 5 minutes? I want to share with you my idea. Stack the deck, right? Because it's you, and you have a Tom Brady problem, you're not starting from the end. I have bad news, you're starting from behind, right? So you need to stack the deck. And it's easy to do, but it's also easy not to do, right? Because what do? And I do this too. You just show up and you're like, all right, oh, it's this person, this person, this person. Right? I don't know any of them. I'm doomed, right? How much better would it have been? And that's one of the great things about social media. I mean, Paige gave some great tips. You can reach out to them on social ahead of time and say, hey, I'm going to be at your presentation. I'm going to be at the school. Do you mind if I stop by? Right? And just say hi. Drop something off. You have the ability to stack stuff down. Right? So if you have a Tom Brady problem, right, I want you to remember that you need to cross the chasm. You need to see how other people see you, why they see you that way, and start from here, not from there. And they may come over to you. And also, you want to stack the deck, right? You don't want to just let people decide once you get in there. You want them on your side before you get there. And here's the great irony of this message. And again, disclaimer, I'm not a huge sports guy, so I'm not going to go into draft type stuff. Tom Brady was selected like really late, right? When he was coming out of college in Michigan, right? And it's kind of shocking now, right? Because we know everything that he's done. We're like, oh my gosh, all those teams messed up. Like, they could have had him, right? Does anyone know when he was selected? Which number? 199. Think about that, right? I don't know how many people are in this room. But imagine you're with a 199th person pick. How did that make you feel? Right? What kind of support do you think you would get when you showed up to work for the team on the first day? You're number 199. People are like, I don't have time for you. I'm working with number 4, 5, and 6 that we got. Right? So here's the thing. Here's the irony. Tom Brady was a victim of the Tom Brady problem. There were 6 quarterbacks picked ahead of him, and none of them did anything close to what he did. So the point of that is the Tom Brady problem is not just a problem for you if you don't look like Tom Brady. If you look like Tom Brady, that's great, right? Nothing against Tom Brady. We want a lot of Toms on our team. Not saying we don't want Tom, right? But if you don't look like Tom Brady, you may not get the support and the presumption of what your potential is. And that's going to be a challenge for you. There may be people like Tom Brady who are selected ahead of you next year, next time, next project, you're going with someone else. And that is not going to be good for you. Maybe you've experienced that already. I'm sorry if you have. I know anyone who doesn't look like Tom Brady, life is a little bit harder, right? So funny thing about this is I'm going to read some quotes from actual scouts when they evaluated Tom Brady. Interesting. He looks like one of those poles you hang your coats on. 7 Super Bowls. He's a very good deep passer, highly competitive. Can't run a lick, but he can set out of the way. Right? Won his last Super Bowl 20 years after his first one. He's bony. He's very thin. Good Lord, you can see the ribs on his build. Holds pretty much every single quarterback record in the NFL worth anything, right? So even Tom Brady, before he became Tom Brady, was a victim, or could be a victim, of the Tom Brady problems. And I tell you this to sort of inspire you, right? Because I don't want you to have hate in your heart towards Tom Brady, unless maybe you're a Giants fan or a Jets fan, that's fine. But even someone like Tom Brady, who was a victim of the Tom Brady problems, because he didn't look like an athletic, strong, fast NFL quarterback, right? You can still become a champion, right? But you're gonna have to do the things that actually work to help you become a champion. So I'm just gonna stop here. If anyone has any questions or perspectives, and if you think this doesn't make sense, I would love to hear from you. Speak up so they can all hear. What if Tom Brady was the person I had to convince? In what respect? Like, he's on the other side?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And
it might be Tom Brady.
And I'm trying to be Tom Brady. Great question. Right? You're going to hear a lot about authenticity, right? As you move on. And guess what? I'm never going to look like Tom Brady, right? I'm never going to get any taller. I'm never going to get any taller. Well, I suppose I could get faster. I'm never going to get as fast as an NFL quarterback. And I can't throw a football with a lick. So I can't convince Tom Brady, hey, Tom, let's go toss the ball around, right? He would kill me. I'd like catch the ball and I'd like get a bruise, right? No, but what you can do, right? It's a really good question, is when you walk over to the other side, guess what? Do you think Tom Brady likes good food? Yeah. Do you think Tom Brady likes to laugh? Do you think Tom Brady cares about his family? Do you think Tom Brady wants to get smarter? Right? Do you think Tom Brady wants to get more dangerous on the field? Right? Of course. These are all things that you can share in common with him without becoming an NFL quarterback, without becoming a Division I college quarterback. Right? So if you can come over to that chasm and connect from his perspective, what cares about him, all of a sudden you don't become someone different. You become more like him. And now he's more willing to support you. What else? What are other challenges, questions that you may have going forward as part of this whole wonderful process you have right now? So the question was, have you ever experienced discrimination when applying for a job? All right? So it's a great question. And guess what? You may never know 100% what it was that got you out. And it could very well be that. Right? And guess what? I'm not going to tell you. I'm not going to hire you because you're not Asian. You're not good looking enough. It's like Abercrombie and Fitch or some sort of like thing where like looks are really like a pattern. No one's ever gonna tell you that, right? You're never gonna know. And frankly, you can't change or shouldn't have to change who you are, right? But what you can do and what you should do, what's entirely in your power, is your ability to connect with that person, right? If you can connect with that person, guess what? They start to see you as one of us instead of others. That is your biggest enemy towards getting what you want. People seeing you as other. You're not a good fit, right? You're not my type of person. Right? You're not my type of guy, my type of gal that I would want on my team, right? That is your greatest enemy. And so what you can do there is you don't want to just start dressing like those people or doing everything just to make it seem like you're something you're not. But guess what? Who you really are is your superpower. Right? It's your superpower. If there's a problem, it's a problem. Your superpower is also your greatest weakness. Have you ever tried to be more real to people and then people kind of got upset at you? Right? They said, oh, I want you to be real, but not that real, right? And then you start to wonder, wait a second. You get to be real, or your real is more important than my real? Right? How does that feel? That doesn't seem fair, right? Well, here's the thing. If you are connected to that person, if they already feel a strong connection to you, that realness becomes interesting. That realness becomes fascinating. You can do a lot more. So I'm going to fast forward you for a second for those of you who will, you know, work in office type setting if you're not virtual, right? One thing that always happens is people heat stuff up in the pantry or the kitchen. Right? Who likes microwave popcorn? Right? Yeah. Well, you know what? People at work, they may like it, but they hate to smell it, right? Because it stinks up the whole room. Right? Here in Fort Lee, lots of great Korean restaurants. Who likes Korean food? Right? Korean stews, right? Right? Good stuff. Guess what? Bring that into work. You're gonna get some hateful looks. Right? People are gonna be like, what? So let's play a scenario, okay? It's you, it's your first day on the job at Google, Amazon, BMW, whatever companies you get into, right? Walk in there, and you bring some stinky sundubu, right? Maybe you just visited Korea with a friend, went to all the best restaurants. I love this stuff. When you come home, you go to a restaurant right here in Fort Lee, you order it, you want to bring it in for lunch, you got leftovers. You go in and you're so happy, and you come in all the banchan, all the side dishes, and you stick it in the microwave, you heat that thing up. Oh, the aroma, right? And then other people start walking into the kitchen, and they see you. You're the newbie. No one even knows your name even. You just got your badge. How do you think they're going to react to what you're doing? They're going to be like, how dare you? How dare you come into our house and heat up this thing? Right? Now, here's the thing. It would be a shame if you don't get to eat what you want. Right? It would be a shame for you to only have to eat pizza or cold cuts because that's inoffensive to everyone. But there's a trick here. Let's imagine that instead of you being your first day, it's been like 4 or 5 years, and you are a rock star at the company, right? You are one of the most highly sought after employees, speakers, presenters, people love you. Anyone who's associated with you, their stock goes up. You do the same exact thing. You are heating up this stinky food, right? And people walk in and they see you. Let's say your name is Pat. Let's say your name is Jamie. Okay, so you could be a man or a woman. So your name is Jamie. And they're like, oh my God, it's Jamie. How do you think they would react to what you're heating up now? They'd be like, hey, Jamie, it's so good to see you. I loved your presentation the other day. What is that you're heating up? It's got a very different smell. Right? And you say, oh, you know, I just came back from Korea with my friend. Heated this thing up. It's amazing. You should try it. Now, one of two things may happen. They may say, oh, I don't like spicy food. I'm not going to try it. And they say, oh, you know what? I'm feeling a little adventurous today. Let me try it. Right? And then you warn them it's going to be hot, right? Especially if they don't like hot food. What a difference. Right? Have you changed what you're doing? No. Heating up the same food, same place, same people in the office. What's different? What has changed?
The context.
Sorry?
The context.
The context? Yeah, exactly. Specifically, your connection to the people in the organization. So what I always like to say, it's like a seesaw. If your connection is really strong and high, your authenticity, right? It helps. It makes you more interesting. It makes you innovative. It makes you out of the box thinker. If your connection is more like disconnection, right? People don't know you, or even worse, they don't like you. Every different thing about you becomes hateful. I can't stand that about that person, right? They're just looking for an excuse to not like you. And anything that you do that is different from what they expect and what they do is going to be used against you in their mind, right? In their perception of you to not really like you. So what this is really about is about managing expectations. Right? You have to understand, what is the expectation that people have of you, right? And what a lot of us do is we work so hard at becoming good at the thing that we do, right? It's like digging that hole. Like, good at digging a hole in the desert. Really good digging skills. Best digger ever. But sometimes in doing that, and I'm not saying you shouldn't sharpen your skills, you should definitely sharpen your skills, make them razor sharp. But you can neglect another skill which is equally as important, which is managing people's expectations of your skill. Because if they don't see your skill the way you want it to be seen, the way it should be seen, you may be sent to the desert to dig holes, right? Where, I don't know, Josh, who has equally or maybe even less good digging skills as you, but people just love this guy. I don't know what it is about him, you know? Like, we just think he's going to be great. You know, I see him like a CEO, he's going to be great. They're going to send him to the oil-rich fields of Dubai or Saudi Arabia or, you know, Oklahoma. Dig there. Oh, he's going to get a huge bonus because he struck oil. Right? So that's the difference. If you don't expectations will manage you. Let me say that one more time. If you don't manage expectations, expectations will manage you. Last call for any questions, any comments?
How long did it take you to learn
this lesson? How long did it take me to learn this lesson? So embarrassing, so embarrassing. All right, so people tell me I look younger than I am. I'm gonna be 50 in a few years.
Wow.
All right? Yep. And I learned this lesson like maybe 2 years ago. So thank you for that question. It's not embarrassing. And here's the thing, I spent a lot of time, I've accomplished a lot in my life, right? Went to UVA, one of the best public schools, went to Georgetown Law, always graduated on time, you know, worked with the best companies, right? KPMG, amazing global, they made $32 billion last year across the globe. I can't even process that number, $32 billion? Like, where do you even find $32 billion, right? That's what the entire organization made. I've been working for them for 15 years. Two stints. But I didn't understand this until a couple years ago when I started thinking more about it. Because what happens in your career a lot of times, you know, you start off like this, and then at the top it gets harder, right? Because there's fewer spaces at the top. And then you kind of start to go like this, right? Because there's only a couple spaces at the top. And then if you don't keep pushing or you get discouraged, you may actually start to go like this. And then the young whippersnappers who are coming up after you, they keep going. You see people who you manage, the people younger than you getting promoted above you. That can totally happen. I've seen it happen all the time. It happened to me as well recently, actually. A mentee, brilliant woman who I mentored, she's now a little higher than me. And I always knew that she was going to do well. I could see the talent, the drive that she had inside. So I learned this quite late in life, so hopefully my gift to you is to think about this thing now, right? Think about just a little thing you can do to manage. Next time you're about to show up to an interview or even like a lunch with someone who could affect your career, right? Don't just show up and be like, all right, let's see what's up. Right? Stack the deck, right? Find out about them. Ask questions. Maybe before you show up, say, hey, can we have a quick chat? I'm really excited to see you. I want to make sure I get a chance to talk to you. Just, you know, wanted to share a couple things. It'll be 5 minutes and I'll see you at lunch. Right? Stack the deck. Keep stacking it, your chances will get better and better, you'll go higher and higher, and you'll be able to fulfill your full potential. So thank you for your attention.